Hello, dear friends, and welcome to the Warner Bible Study from our Warner Ministry Department here at Warner University in Lake Wales, Florida. I'm Tim Dwyer. I'm professor of Bible and ministry, and this is our first study of the spring semester 2020. Today, we're continuing in the Gospel of Matthew, talking about Matthew chapter 13. Let me remind you of a couple big picture things in regards to the Gospel of Matthew. We talked about before how Matthew has kind of three clear segments and two turning points. One of those turning points is in chapter 4 and verse 17 when it says, "From that time Jesus began." The great scholar of Matthew, David Bowers, made the clear thought that that's a turning point. And after that, Jesus begins his ministry and launches forth in Galilee. And then in chapter 16 and verse 21, it says again, "From that time Jesus began." At that point, you have the confession of Peter and the move to the cross is beginning. So you have kind of three clear sections in Matthew, the first leading up to 4:17, the second going to 16:21, and the third going all the way through chapter 28. Now, when we come to Matthew chapter 13, we come to a very crucial chapter. It's a chapter that is, in some senses, a turning point, maybe not in the structure of Matthew, but in the way that the Lord Jesus Christ deals with Israel. You'll remember that in chapter 4, he announced the kingdom, and in chapter 4, he started to call some of the disciples, and then after teaching the Sermon on the Mount, in chapters 5, 6, and 7, he begins his ministry with different healings and different wonders, different signs, different exorcisms. By time you get to chapter 12, here's what's happened. The conflict that has begun earlier in Matthew has come to a culminating point. And in chapter 12, the Pharisees say that Jesus is doing the things which he's doing by the power of the devil, by the power of Beelzebul. So in chapter 13, Jesus makes a new turn with how he teaches. He starts to teach in parables. And his parables, he will say, are about the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. The mysteries basically means this, taking a phrase from Daniel, for instance, Daniel chapter 2, it's the idea that the kingdom of heaven is going to have a great failure to it. We'll see that three of the four soils have seed that fails. On the other hand, it's going to have a remarkable and unusual success. So after his works are attributed to the power of the evil one, Jesus turns and talks about the mysteries of the kingdom. What's chapter 13 contain? Well, it contains really eight sections. You have a parable of the soils, and then that is explained a little bit later on in the chapter. You have a parable of the wheat and the tares, and there the tares and the wheat look so much alike that the Lord, the Master, decides to kind of let them grow together because they are so remarkably similar. And then you have what might be called the parable of the mustard weed, not mustard seed, but mustard weed. And that's followed by a parable of leaven, where a woman hides leaven in bread and bakes enough bread for about 100 people. And then after that, you have another parable about the treasure, followed by the pearl. We'll see some enigmas to that. Then there's one about a dragnet, where with 30 or more varieties of fish in the Sea of Galilee, there's a dragnet that comes in and brings in all the fish. Some are obviously clean and unclean in Jewish law. Then Jesus describes the ideal scribe that brings forth treasures old and new. And finally, he goes to his hometown, and at Nazareth, there is met with great unbelief. So let me give you this chapter in two brief segments with those eight sections. Here's the first segment, background. In the parables, there's a lot of important background information we need, such as, why is the ground not prepared? Why is the farmer, in essence, so careless? Or why does the woman bake bread for 100 people? Or why does the produce of the soil, why is it so great, 30, 60, and 100-fold, when the normal produce would be maybe 4 to 7 times? Or why is it that a person has a pearl, and once you have a pearl, you have something priceless, but you can't wear it and you can't eat it? There's a sense in which it's not pragmatically valuable. And why, what about the treasure in the field? Once you have a field, are you going to keep the treasure, sell part of the treasure? What? So there's some enigmas to the chapter here. But with those enigmas, this chapter raises some very serious spiritual questions. Let me take, for example, the second parable, the parable of the wheat and the tares. It says that in this life, believers and unbelievers may look very much alike. And it's not to the end that they're going to be separated by the Lord. We might think of someone like Judas, but even Judas eventually revealed himself when he took the silver and when he brought the people resting Christ to Jesus. Or we might think about the parable of the soils and how three of the four don't produce, but they reveal themselves. But the wheat and the tares is even more tricky. It says that there are unbelievers that may look like believers all the way up to the second coming. And so we might ask this question: have you known someone that you were convinced was a believer, but is there a possibility at the second coming or at the judgment day we'll decide or we'll discover or we'll learn they were really hidden by the evil one as like a spy undercover, like was done in, for instance, the Cold War? So let me think about five questions with you. Here's the first. Is it possible to recognize someone who's a tare? A Zizania, which looks so much like the wheat, is it possible to recognize them? Second question. Is it possible for a person, maybe you, to be a tare without realizing it? In Matthew chapter 7, Matthew chapter 25, people think they are saved all the way up until the judgment. Here's the third question. Is it possible that there are tare churches, churches which look like the true body of Christ but are not? The fourth question, how does the parable of the tares relate to the soils? My colleague, Dr. Craig Miles, says when the evil one can't choke the growing seed, the evil one will even sow seeds that look like the fourth seed. And then a fifth question. How's it related to Jesus' rejection at Nazareth? You can note an interesting word if you have a Bible that's very literal. It will say in the parable of the soils that some seeds are caused to stumble. But then when Jesus goes to his hometown, it will say they stumbled at him. In other words, what happens at Nazareth is a living example of how there can be soils which do not bear fruit. But the even trickier thing to ask is this: can we be sure that we, our friends, our church, even our loved ones, can we be sure that they are actual believers in Christ, not tares in disguise? And maybe that's a question to ask of ourselves personally. Have I tested myself to make sure I'm a true child of the kingdom? Someone who brings forth treasures old and new from the Torah, from the prophets, from the teaching of Jesus, truly disciple. Because remember, the purpose of the Gospel of Matthew is to teach us how to be disciples of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and how to make disciples. God bless you as you serve him. If you're here on the Warner campus, you might want to join us on Thursdays at noon in Pontius Building 202. Otherwise, tune in every week for the updates. God bless you and keep us in your prayers. Goodbye.